The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewan Cameron.
Hello and welcome to episode 74 of the Big Scottish Football Podcast. I'm Stephen Mill, he is Ewan Cameron. How you doing? You all right? Good morning.
I don't know whether we should be saying that.
How?
Because it might not be good morning where somebody's listening.
You say it almost every week.
I don't.
Yes, you do.
It could be afternoon or evening for some people.
Right, okay, just to clarify for everyone listening or if you're watching on YouTube as well, we're recording this on Monday morning, so good morning if you're listening to this maybe somewhere else in the world.
In Greenwich Mean Time.
Yes.
In Greenwich Mean Time, good morning.
Yes, exactly.
If it's United Arab Emirates time, which is
4 hours ahead at the moment.
So it's lunchtime, it's good afternoon.
No, it's past lunchtime. It would be 20 past 3 in the afternoon.
But it's still
good
afternoon.
I don't know what time you have your lunch, but I didn't have mine.
If you're in the Far East, it's good evening.
In the Far East, yes. And of course, if you're listening maybe
in the United States and Canada.
In Eastern Time, USA, so that's 5 hours behind. It would be 20 past 6 in the morning.
Good morning to you.
So, exactly. So, I was
That's fine.
I was sticking in our time zone more than anything.
That's fine. That's good.
Okay, glad I've got your silly approval for that. And how was your weekend? Was it okay? Was it fine?
I spent a bit of the weekend with you.
Mm-hmm.
We watched the rugby. Scotland versus France at Murrayfield. And it was, I was distraught.
I'm just going to stop you there. Nobody's interested. You can go and listen to the rugby podcast if you want. Oh, sorry.
Stephen, we are from Scotland. We're very proud of our name. We're very proud. Wait, can I just make the point?
No, make the point that it's not a rugby podcast?
I never
and
said
we're
not
it was. Here to chat about
I never, at no point did I suggest it was a rugby podcast.
And it's what I said last year when it was the World Cup. Obviously, I want Scotland to win when it comes to rugby. I want them to win when it comes to
tiddlywinks.
Anything.
Mm-hmm.
But Scotland didn't win on Saturday, and my reaction was, oh well, and then I got on with the rest of my day.
Well, it kind of affected me at the weekend.
Right, okay.
It really bothered
me. That's fine.
Well,
you can save that for the Big Scottish Rugby Podcast.
But I don't do a podcast on rugby.
Well, maybe you should, because this isn't the platform for it.
I think even football fans at the weekend were disgusted and distraught at that shocking decision at the end of the game. Scotland should have won that and should still be with a chance of winning the Grand Slam. So it kind of affected my weekend, and that's all I'm going to say on it. All right?
Great. We can all move on now.
Wait. Before we go any further, I've got a recommendation for you. Can you fire off my bit of music?
See this bit, right?
Punters love it.
No.
Because
punters hate it.
No, they don't. They absolutely love it. So I'm going to recommend a TV show and not a movie this week. And the TV show is... Keep that music going. I love it. The TV show is... True Detective Season 4. Now, there were 3 seasons before that. True Detective 1, yep. True Detective 2, True Detective 3. They're not connected in any way. They're different series, but it's got the same sort of premise about police and trying to solve crimes, etc. In Season 1, which I thoroughly enjoyed, it starred Woody Harrelson and Matthew McConaughey. That was my impersonation of Matthew McConaughey.
Cool.
All right. Sounds just like him, doesn't it?
Mm.
All right. So Season 1 was phenomenal. Wasn't a big fan of Season 2. Season 3 was pants as well. So I thought, I'm going to give Season 4 a go of True Detective, starring Academy Award winner Jodie Foster. So I started watching it the weekend, and I highly recommend it. There's only 6 episodes. I've got through 4 episodes, and what it is, Jodie Foster is like the chief of police in Alaska. And when you live in Alaska, there are certain points in the year where you live in darkness 24 hours a day. So you're going out for lunch and it's dark. There's no daylight at certain points of the year in Alaska. So it's during this period of time where it's dark 24/7, where there's this research facility, there's all these people living in this research facility, and they suddenly go missing out of nowhere. Nobody knows where they've gone, what happened to them. And what happens at some point in episode 1, they find the 6 people that have gone missing, and they're naked and they're frozen in a block of ice.
Ewan, like, gonna just tell people to watch something without telling them what happens in it.
I'm not going to tell you what happens because I don't know what happens.
No, because
I don't know why they're frozen in a block of ice.
I've watched it.
All six episodes?
No, I've watched the first three episodes.
Same as me?
Yeah, exactly.
Right? So they find...
No, but why? That's a big part in the first, like, episode. You've just given it away.
You've not given anything away.
You've given away the ending for the first episode.
That they find the six people in the ice?
Yes! That's the ending of the first episode.
But there's five more episodes to come, so what I'm doing is by telling you that... That's going to intrigue people.
No, it's not. It's basically going, well, I didn't need to watch the first episode anymore.
No, I'd still watch it because it sets it up lovely for the rest of the series. So I would watch it for that. So they find that the guy's in the ice and they're frozen and they're naked and they're going, well, why are they naked? Why are they frozen? Why are they in the ice? Why are they looking like they've been, their faces are all screwed up?
Shut up! You're giving away so much of the plot here.
Should I mention the fact that they take the block of ice and they lift the men into the town?
No!
None of that.
Don't mention that.
All right.
Just let people watch it.
Do you think it's something to do with aliens?
To be honest, I think it's been pish. But I'm watching it on the basis that I've started watching it now and I'm going to have to finish it.
To see what happened to the guys.
To see what happens.
I'll tell you, by the way, see how there were six guys who went missing? They only found five in the ice. Where's the sixth guy? Where is he? Has he got something to do with it? Is that giving anything away?
Well, again, if you've not watched it, then another serious plot line given away.
No, is there?
By you, and that's per usual.
It's True Detective Season 4 with Jodie Foster, and she's looking great for 61. I had to ask my smart speaker, how old... I stopped the TV show, I paused it, and I went, Alexa, how old is Jodie Foster? How old do you think she is?
She's 61.
She's 61?
Yeah, because you just told me.
Did I say that?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So True Detective is my recommendation, and it's in Alaska, and it's very, very good. Do you know what it reminded me of a wee bit? Remember the movie The Thing?
No. I mean, I've heard of it, but I've not seen it.
Classic movie. They were in a research facility in the middle of nowhere with snow and ice, and it's got a wee hint of that about it.
See, if it's something stupid like that, it'll annoy me.
Okay. But they're seeing ghosts.
Aye, it's beginning to annoy me.
Right, there's ghosts in it because they're following ghosts into the ice.
Because, like, I really liked the first series as well.
Woody Harrelson and Matthew McConaughey.
But it was kind of real. Like, there wasn't...
Correct. It was about a serial killer.
Yeah.
Yes.
Whereas, like, see the moment you start bringing in, like, aliens...
And ghosts.
And ghosts in that. Like, nah.
But they do see dead people. In this season, this series, they're seeing dead people.
Shite.
What about that wife that's walking around with her husband who's dead?
Stop giving away plot lines for this series.
If I was listening to this, I would be intrigued with
the fact... No, you wouldn't. You'd be like, you've just spoiled it for me.
There are naked men in ice and there's ghosts. I mean, what's not to love about that?
Okay, thank you for your correspondence on last week's show. We asked you if you were a member of the 100% Club.
Aye.
And listened to every single episode. And it turns out there are actually lots of you that have done so.
Well done.
So thank you to the following people. Average Joe, Graham McFarlane, Claire Pollock, Sarah Tate, Ross Coles, Mods 1, Scott Richard, Mark Rennie, Mark McGuire, George Burns, Graham Shinney's Beer, Stuart Smith, Gary Dunn, Sean94RFC, Jonesy Boy, User IJ, Stephen Sharkey, Paul Ireland, Kyle Hanna, Willie6788, Adam Theaker, Big Time Burgers. You can take over here because I need to cough. On you go.
It's on
the front. It's on the front. There it is there. I'll give you...
I need to get through the rest of the names.
Yes.
Okay. Nicola 8075, Chris McKechnie, Innes Mackay, Super Gaza, Danny H, Porgy Boy, Stu Wilson, Arthur Long, Martin McSorley, Brian Stalker, Blue Nose 139, Adele Maxwell, Alan Till. Is there any more? Oh, and more. And there's a lot more we haven't actually named there. So he's done a runner. He's actually left the studio. I do not know where he has gone. Am I being set up here for something? He's actually left the studio. He shut both doors behind him and he's left me here to read out these names and I'm now finished with the names. What is going on here? I'm a wee bit worried. Is there somebody coming in? What's going on?
Nothing.
Did you actually just go and cough?
Yeah.
Genuinely?
Yeah.
You're not setting me up for something here, are you?
No. Right. How paranoid are you? I just had a coughing fit.
I don't trust you. Did you have a proper coughing fit?
Yeah, I've not been well, and I didn't want to cough on camera and down a mic.
That's just real life. You could just stand in the corner of the studio and cough.
I know, but it's horrible. You don't want to hear people coughing.
That's true, but that was just some of the names that are in the 100% Club. I think I did, aye.
All right.
There's loads of them.
BPE 2004. I'm in the 100% club. I have listened to every one of them, including the mysterious episode one. I have never actually watched an episode, and I've only came on here to post this. I don't think I could watch his happy dance in HD. That was obviously your happy dance from last week.
Yeah, deservedly so. Hearts have finished third in the league.
Dizzy Sean says, I'm 100%, lol, and it even causes fights. As soon as I see it's available, I stick the episode on, and my girlfriend hates you guys. I personally don't think one episode a week is enough. My favourite podcast by far. Good laugh, keep up. Thank you very much, Sean. Sarah Tate says, watching you and Stephen in the bath before watching the Rangers game. I'm a 100% club, but this is my first time actually watching. My favourite time of the week is this podcast.
And she watches us in the bath.
Uh-huh.
I mean, the last week's podcast was 90 minutes long.
Yeah.
Does she sit in the bath for 90 minutes?
Like a prune.
Aye. What's her name?
Sarah Tate.
I mean, I like a bath and I do like sitting in the bath for a while. I have actually watched a football match in the bath. So, Sarah Tate, I kind of know what it's like to sit in a bath, but I like to sit in the bath with some food and a glass of wine
while
I watch.
In the bath?
Aye.
Oh, you're a monster. Like, this is so weird because you're really, really odd about food. Like, you never...
Yeah, I'm a bit odd with food.
You'll never reheat food or anything like that. But you'll eat food in the bath.
Yeah, what's wrong
with that? When it's all steamy and it's near water.
Stephen, I'm not having a roast dinner in the bath.
What are you having?
I might have a packet of crisps.
A packet of crisps in the bath?
Why is that weird? I might have a packet of crisps.
Would you eat in the shower?
No, because that'll get wet. No, but if I'm in the bath, like, what's her name again?
Sarah Tate.
Sarah Tate, who sat in the bath watching the show, I will put the iPad up and I'll watch maybe the football, maybe the second half of a game in the bath, and I'll have a glass of wine and maybe a bar of chocolate. Or I'll have a beer and a packet of crisps while I'm in the bath watching the football.
That's weird.
Why is that weird?
Eating crisps in the bath. Do they not go soggy?
Because you just open up the bag and eat it. I'm sitting up in the bath. I'm not under the water.
No, I know that, but even the air is like...
Oh, I know what you mean. It's kind of
moisture.
Warm and moisture and sticky and all that stuff. No. I just... As soon as I open up the bag, cheese and onion, bottle of beer, watching the football.
Monster.
Sarah was drinking wine in the bath watching us. Was it, you know?
I think having a drink is different from eating.
Oh, I like to eat in the bath. I've had a sausage roll in the bath. Teresa made some sausage rolls and she asked if I wanted one. She handed me one into the bath. Is that weird?
Yes, it is.
And bits of the pastry fell into the bath, but I just scooped up and then threw it in the toilet. Soggy pastries
are
good.
You're an odd man.
I'm not really.
Brian, I can confirm I have not missed one episode, the whole 73. However, Stephen, if you don't stop this film review pish by Jambobear, then you leave us all no choice of one-star reviews. This is what I'm talking about. Stop doing it. It's
punters love it.
Well, Brian doesn't. Brian's a punter.
There's a boy whose name I can't remember, right? And I had a conversation with him on Twitter.
Well, no, I'm getting to that, actually. So Fizz3565, keep up the movie recommendations. It does give me something to watch and pass on to the family. Another person, big fan of the movie segment. I have no plan of watching any of the films, but it means less of Ewan's footballing opinions. It seems to tire him out a bit. Paddy B says, heard Ewan's movie recommendation this week. Went on to search where it was streaming for free in the UK, and apparently the answer is nowhere. I wonder where Ewan is getting his movies. Can you find out what in the name of dodgy fire sticks is going on here? Love the show. It's on Sky, is it not?
It's on Sky. It's on Sky. No hard feelings.
Barca Bear says, Ewan's movie recommendation was a bit weird this week. He obviously picked that movie so he could tell everyone about the story about how he lost his virginity at the age of 1920. Clearly 20. Even weirder that he refused to leave her alone for 3 days and still messages her big sister.
She was 37 and I was in my late teens, early 20s, all right? It was every teenage boy's dream.
Right. Lots of chat about your story from last week. Mark Doyle, that was a brilliant story. You and I was hanging on every word. Good on you for having the balls to go and get what you wanted.
It was...
Jesus Christ. Berk says, incredible teenage love conquest story from Ewan. I reckon even the Dazzler Gordon DL would struggle to spin a porky that far fetched.
I wish it. I don't wish it was a porky. It was one of the greatest days or days
Ross
in my life.
Tannen says, all that was missing from Ewan's older woman story was after 3 days, he did his happy dance when he left the room. RJ Demon says Martin Scorsese's movies are shorter than Ewan's stories. Biggin says, Stephen, why do you allow Ewan to torture us? First his subway story, now this attempt to try to be Stifler. Have mercy on us. Producer note, it was actually Finch who went with Stifler's mum.
Yeah, it was Finch.
Not Stifler that went with Stifler's mum. That would be an entirely different plot line
yes.
from an entirely different film.
And it's a different website.
Paul Cassidy says, did Ewan do his happy dance on the third day in Abu Dhabi? That's how he got chucked out of the lassie's room. And finally, maybe the best review we have had. Hello to Colin Little. Say hello to Colin Little in the
Hi,
camera.
Hi, Colin Little. Lovely to have you. And thanks for listening and watching, mate.
I was honestly raging when they did a U2 and dropped this into the Super Scoreboard podcast feed last season. For weeks it sat there, an unflushable jobby. I refused to listen to it out of principle, but in a moment of weakness I relented and I am now hooked. This is how coercion works. Well, listen, Colin, it's great to have you on board.
Yes.
The unflushable jobby that continues to be here. So remember, you can always leave your comments on the YouTube video. If you're watching there, we'll get straight to them. Obviously, you can leave your comments throughout the show. We always appreciate them, whatever it is, whatever you want to say to us, whatever it's about, then we do love to hear from you. So leave your comments on the YouTube channel and also on our Twitter feed, at BigFootballScott as well.
Can I say hello to Nicky Roberts? Who's a fellow Fifer.
Yes.
Nicky Robertson, who's a fellow Fifer, who also sent us a tweet to say that she's part of the 100% Club and also sent a picture of herself with a glass of rosé wine watching the show.
Right, but not in the bath, crucially.
No, she was in her bed.
Right, okay.
With a glass of rosé wine watching the podcast.
Perfectly acceptable. Definitely acceptable.
So I know that's acceptable, but I don't know why you think that watching a podcast or watching a movie or watching the football in the bath is unacceptable.
I don't. I think that
eating in a bath.
In the bath.
Okay, can I put that question out there?
Yeah, of course you can.
If you're watching on YouTube, if you're listening to us on Spotify or whatever, send us a comment. Is it unusual to eat in the bath? I personally don't think it is. As long as you don't make a mess in the bath and it's crumbling all over the place, I don't see the issue with it.
I wish you hadn't asked that question, because it's going to give a stunning insight into people who listen to this podcast, and I don't think I want to know. To be honest with you, it might be better out of sight, out of mind kind of thing.
You never eaten in a bath?
No.
At all?
No.
What's the longest time you'll sit in a bath? Have you watched anything in a bath?
Nah.
Right, so then you...
Baths bore me. Like, I'm in a bath for about 10 minutes, and then I'm like, I'm sitting in my own filth, and then I'll have to get up and have a shower.
And bubbles and candles and an iPad.
It's not Sex in the City, Ewan. Like Carrie Bradshaw sitting across there, writing your journal.
But it's true, though. That's what I like.
Well, if that's what you like, that's what you like. But I'm just saying, I can't be arsed with a bath. I only have a bath if something's wrong. Like, if I'm not feeling well or I'm aching or something like that.
And do you know the best thing about a bath, right? And I like the bath water to get tepid warm and then kind of cold, and then you start to shiver a wee bit. And the best feeling ever is it when you get to that point where then you run the hot water and it's a mixture of cold and hot, and then you can feel the hot water moving its way up your body and then up your stomach and then up to your chest and then under your chin. And you've got the cold water underneath, but you've got the hot water on top. It's the best feeling ever.
Well, if that's...
But you don't stir it, because you want that feeling of cold and hot at the same time. And then at some point you have to mix it up and it becomes really nice and warm. And you can get back to your wine and your packet of crisps.
I'll go back to what I said a few minutes ago. You're a really odd man sometimes. You really are.
And then you get out your bath and then the first thing you do is you moisturise yourself.
No.
Because your pores are open.
Right enough. Scottish Cup.
We won 4-1. We absolutely pumped Airdrie and we played like Man City. Unbelievable. And I actually think that Stephen Naismith in with a chance of replacing Jurgen Klopp at Liverpool. Is that good?
I mean, well, he would have been out of job a few months ago if it was for you.
That's very true, but it's amazing what's happened.
Do you ever just sit back sometimes and realise how wrong you were?
But at the time, I was right.
No, but you weren't.
Well, ultimately, I've turned out to be wrong. But at the time, I was angry, and so were the Hearts fans. He was under a lot of pressure after the run of results we were in. It was shocking. We were playing badly as well. But
no,
listen.
But the whole point that I made to you all the time.
Give him time.
Was give him time.
He'd only just got the job.
And also, you were only like 3 points off third or something, or in third, and you were still wetting your knickers.
Right, listen. It's very easy for you, who supports a lower league team, to sit there and tell me, give him time, etc., etc., etc. But you needed to live in my shoes to understand how I felt at that time.
Who I support is absolutely irrelevant.
Wait, listen. Stephen Naismith, untried, untested, no experience. And we get off to a really poor...
All managers are untried, untested, and have no experience at one stage. Yeah, Everyone has.
But then someone like Stephen Naismith should be learning his trade at somewhere like a Dunfermline. That's my point.
Right, so...
So he gets a massive job at Hearts, and I wasn't supporting that particular move. And at the beginning, it proved as... I was being proved right at the beginning, because at the tail end of last season, it was shit. The start of the season, it was pish. And do you know what? Can I just... We round of applause for Stephen Naismith, because he was on the telly last night being interviewed by the BBC, and he talked about the criticism that he got in that first couple of months, and he understood it. That's what he said. He got it, because they were playing badly. But he goes, it was going to take time for us to implement our style of football, and yeah, we're finally there.
You weren't... Aye, but at the time, like, this is complete revisionism from you, because you're like, oh, it was all part of the plan. I was just trying to encourage him to play better. No, you weren't. You wanted him out the door. And it was all... Every single thing that you just said there, i.e. you need to give him time, he needs to stamp his own authority. I said that to you and you were like, this is Hearts, this is different.
If you go back and you listen to the old shows, I was screaming for a 4-2-3-1. And what's he playing now? That's all I'm going to say. So thanks for listening, Stephen, and well done to Hearts reaching the quarterfinals of the Scottish Cup.
So that's the only reason, because that's the only reason.
He's done a great job, right, in the last couple of months, and the team have been fantastic.
They've lost 1 in 14 or 15 or whatever it is.
Aye, and we're only 10 points behind Rangers. Look, we have been sensational in recent weeks, and I thought some of the goals we scored yesterday were just out of this world. I mean, genuinely, and I do mean this, it was like watching Man City. I messaged you in that first goal, in our own half.
I mean, like...
It was Man City-esque, the way we scored that goal.
See, Ewan, this
amazing,
is...
Amazing. Amazing.
When people watch this podcast or hear your opinions or see clips of you online...
I'm a football fan, Stephen. I call it as I see it.
But this is why they go, we can't take him seriously. Because one moment, about 2 months ago, not even that, maybe three... When Hearts lost to Rangers at Tynecastle,
I was upset.
You wanted Stephen Naismith sacked.
I was upset.
That was 2 and a bit months ago.
Yeah, I was upset.
And you've just sat there and said some of the play and some of the goals that Hearts scored yesterday was like seriously watching Man City.
It was.
It wasn't.
It was.
It wasn't.
That first goal,
there's a bit in between?
Shanklin takes three players out while we flick around the corner. And then he runs from the halfway line and gets himself in the penalty spot to slot home the goal. And it goes to Neuenhoff. It goes to Forrest. It goes out to Cochrane. Cochrane cuts it back. And who's there? The man himself, shouting bang, 1-0.
It was a good goal, but you were playing Airdrie, who are a division below you.
4-1, we're through. Should we talk about something else?
No, I was just going to wrap up by saying, you know, what are your chances of winning the cup?
We'll beat Morton in the next round. George Bowie from Bowie at Breakfast, he's a Morton fan. He was at the Motherwell game the other night there. And obviously, with me being a Hearts fan...
I thought Morton were excellent.
Yeah, and him being a Morton fan, we're thinking about going to the game together, but we don't know when that's been played.
No, it's not been announced yet.
It's not been announced yet. But
I suspect it'll be the Friday night.
So George Bowie was very happy this morning. I was very happy this morning. So I thought Morton were sensational on Friday night. They were so much better than Motherwell.
They made it a wee bit difficult for themselves the final 10 minutes or so, mm-hmm. when they conceded the goal and they were hanging on a wee bit. But before that, I thought they were so comfortable.
Your boy up front, Oakley.
I thought that Motherwell completely just played into their hands, though. I mean, Morton, to be fair, pressed Motherwell really well, and all Motherwell were doing were lumping long balls, and yeah. they were just getting gobbled up all day, and they had no answer for Oakley. I thought Muirhead played really well.
Former Hearts player.
And I just think that, Morton thoroughly deserved their win and into the quarterfinals. And by the way, it's not going to be straightforward.
That pitch is horrific. It's not a great pitch.
Funny that. You know what's interesting? You've just actually stumbled upon something here. You said that Hearts scored goals that were like watching Man City. Actually like watching Man City.
It was.
And yet they managed to do that on a plastic pitch yesterday. Could you explain how that is?
I'll explain that to you, because at the start of the coverage yesterday on the BBC, James McFadden, Shelley Kerr and Stephen Thompson were stood in the centre circle to present the opening of the BBC live programme for Airdrie versus Hearts. And the first thing they did was comment on how good that surface was.
It can't be though. It's a plastic pitch.
No. They said, because it's just been relayed. It was just a new. Just been relayed.
So you like it
soft,
new?
It was soft underfoot. Much better than a lot of the other pitches they were hinting at. So they were talking about Kilmarnock and they were talking about Livingston, and it just felt really, really good underfoot.
So you like it plastic pitches soft. if they're good?
No. But
So you're not.
Does make a difference if it's. If it's new and it's bouncy and soft, but over a period of time when you don't relay the surface, it'll be like this, less crap that we're sitting in front of.
So just to ask you a question, you said that Morton's pitch is obviously terrible.
Yeah.
Right. Would you rather play on that or what you played on yesterday for the next round, if you had the choice?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, that's a good question, because the Morton pitch was horrific on Friday night. Mm-hmm. I mean, the ball was bouncing all over the bloody place.
But you hate plastic pitches and you want them ripped up and you say they're an absolute embarrassment to Scottish football.
But in a general sense, yes, they're an embarrassment to Scottish football, especially Kilmarnock and Livingston.
Right.
Hamilton's not great either.
Do you know what I'm
going to do? Can I do something? Can I phone Shelley Kerr and ask her a proper... I've got her number here.
No, you can't. You can't cop out and ask someone else. No, you can't. I want you to answer this question first.
I would... If it was a choice between Morton and...
Bear in mind everything you said about plastic pitches and the massive embarrassment that they've been.
Uh-huh.
Hello?
Shelley, it's Ewen here on the podcast, so don't say anything you shouldn't say. Right, the reason we're phoning you, Shelley, is because obviously I was watching you yesterday with the BBC for the Hearts Airdrie game at the Excelsior Stadium.
Mm-hmm.
And you were on the pitch with James McFadden and Stephen Thompson. And before the game kicked off, you were both, or the three of you were talking about the actual surface and how it felt not too bad. We're just having a discussion here about the plastic pitches and how generally they're quite shite. What did you actually think of that pitch yesterday? Because it was apparently relayed not that long ago.
No, it is one of the better ones. Personally, I'm a great believer that all the pitches, especially in the top division, should be grass. But that one in particular is good. The surface is decent, which allows you to zip the ball about in it.
So it's
quite good.
So the question that Stephen has just asked me, I'm going to ask you. Did you see the game on Friday night, Motherwell versus Morton at Capello?
Yes.
Right. That pitch was horrific. It was bobbling all over the place. So I've just been asked a question. If you could choose to play on the Airdrie pitch or the Capello pitch, which pitch would you want to play on?
God, that's a tough question. I just always want to play in grass.
Even though it's as bobbly as it was?
That's what you... When you grow up playing football, you play in playgrounds, you play in tarmac, you play in ash... And so when you play in a grass pitch, like, I think it helps develop your touch as a young player, but I would much prefer to play on grass, despite, obviously, you know, the conditions. I'd always much rather play in grass.
There you go. Thanks for that, Shelley. How are you keeping anyway?
Fantastic. All the better for hearing your voice.
I know. You love the podcast. You love everything about what we do and all that. You should come in one day and join us for a laugh.
I'm waiting for my invite.
Oh, right, okay, we'll get you in one day soon. What was that like yesterday? What did you think of Hearts' performance before I let you go?
I thought they were really good. Very professional. Thought right through the spine of the team, pretty solid. Real good balance, some good goals, and definitely right now, they're on form.
Are they winning the cup, Shelley?
I think there's every chance.
Shelley's a Hearts fan, by the way. Did you know that, Stephen? Mm-hmm,
yeah.
She's a Hearts fan.
Yeah.
So that's why we got on so, so well, because we're maroon at heart.
Yeah, that's why.
They were very good yesterday. Very good.
Shelley, I'm not that far away from you. what?
Ewen, can we do the podcast, please?
Yeah, no, but every now and then when I speak to Shelley, we always say, well, we should meet for a coffee, but we never do it.
Well, you can do that after the podcast. We've got things to be getting on with. Shelley's got her day to be getting on with as well.
We're pals, we speak often. Shelley will definitely meet for that coffee sooner rather than later. We'll get you in the studio as well.
Sounds fantastic.
Love you.
Bye, Shelley.
You too. Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Right, so what's your answer to the question since you shat it and phoned Shelley Kerr?
I agree with Shelley.
Right, okay.
You would always rather play on grass, but I see the point you're making. It's a very good point, Stephen.
Okay, right. Aberdeen 2, Bonnyrigg Rose 0. Wasn't the best performance, according to Neil Warnock, on Saturday. Bojan Miowski, a couple of good goals as well. He's described Bojan Miowski. What are you doing, Ewan? I'm recording a podcast.
No, but I'm taking a selfie to send to Shelley.
You can do it afterwards. Well, Jesus Christ almighty. Neil Warnock says that Bojan Miowski is the best striker he's ever managed.
That's some statement from a boy who's been there, done it, got the T-shirt. He's been managing for how many decades in English football?
75.
It's unbelievable that he said that. But do you know what? Actually, when you look at the sort of teams that he worked with,
He said he was like, I've always had good goalkeepers, centre-halves, midfielders. He was like, but I've never had that one really, really good striker. And he was like, I think I've finally found it.
Did he not work with the likes of Billy Sharp in that Sheffield United before his time? Because Billy Sharp's a good striker.
Yeah, possibly, but...
But I thought, listen, Miowski is something special. Let's be honest. He's only 24 as well, so his best years are still ahead of him. And he scored two cracking goals. See the first goal, that first
goal,
touch
really
and then
nice
bang.
Finish.
Brilliant finish. Yeah, I've got a lot of time for Miowski. And fair play to Aberdeen for finding such a gem. They're going to make so much money from him. And I'm going to say this now. Aberdeen, do not take anything less than £7 million for him. He's that good a player. And I think he will go into bigger and better things. That's no disrespect to Aberdeen. I'm talking about going to the Premiership or going to Germany or going to Italy. That boy is going places. He's such a good striker.
So... Kilmarnock in the next round for Aberdeen after they beat Cove on Saturday. Made a wee bit heavy weather of it, but eventually got through. Marley Watkins as well, your favourite man of the match, and also scoring his second goal in 4 days as well. Five games unbeaten. They play Celtic at home on Saturday as well, and they will love going to Aberdeen in the next round, I am sure.
Derek McInnes and everything. The storylines around that game are huge.
Now, if you've not seen this, if you just go to like YouTube and after you finish watching the podcast, obviously, and go to, I think it's the Battle of Bramall Lane.
Yes.
And there's a wee Sky Sports thing and they've explained all. Derek McInnes was playing for West Brom in that match. Neil Warnock, it's actually very funny.
Yeah.
So
Derek McInnes, former Aberdeen manager, going back to his old stomping ground, and he's going to be managing against the player from the Battle of Bramall Lane.
Yeah,
that's going to be an interesting watch. There's a lot riding on that game, and both, well, Aberdeen at home you'd have to say are slight favourites, but Kilmarnock are playing really well.
Yep, absolutely.
It's a cracking game that.
Hibs got through again eventually on Saturday. Took until second half to get the breakthrough against Inverness. 3-1 it was, beating last year's finalist at Cali Stadium. So Boyle on the score sheet as well, which Hibs fans will be delighted with.
Good finish.
He's back, and a good finish as well. And they've been drawn, obviously, at home to Rangers, who beat Ayr United on Saturday night.
I think that's a 50-50 game. Scottish Cup, if they can fill that ground out, quarterfinals of the Cup. I thought last week Hibs were very good against Celtic, especially in that second half.
Hibs need to improve.
I think
Rangers just keep winning at the moment.
And they're not playing great, though, but they're winning without playing great. And I think you could say the same about Celtic. But I think that Hibs have got a wee chance because they can't get any bad as they've been. And I thought the second half performance against Celtic was very good. They were very good against Inverness in what was a tricky game. And a lot of people thought that might be a banana skin and that might be where you get the shock. Good professional performance, score 3 goals at a difficult venue. So is this Hibs on the up? Their new signings look not too bad as well. And once they all gel, when it comes round to that game against Rangers, I think it's a 50-50 game because of the home advantage.
Rangers obviously getting past there. United by 2-0, you said yourself there, not the best performance again by Rangers. But me and my mates were talking about this yesterday, actually. You know, since Philip Clement's come in, I don't think Rangers have really blown anyone away.
They were good against Real Betis in that game, 3-2.
Yeah, they did. But I think in general, They haven't been playing great, but you cannot argue with the results.
No,
the results have just been so consistent, obviously, apart from the big one against Celtic.
And the thing about Rangers as well, and this is why the Rangers fans during the January transfer window were screaming for an all-out number nine striker. When you look at their stats, they're averaging something like 24 shots on goal, but only like four or five of them are on target. So if they did have a proper out-and-out striker, who knows how many goals they'd have scored and how more comfortable the results would have been for them. We'll never know. So it's not like they're not creating chances and they're not having shots on goal. They just don't look as though they're playing that great. And the longer a game goes on where it's only 1-0 or 2-1, the opposition have always got a chance. And that's why it gets a bit nervy for them.
And if they play against an opposition with any quality,
correct,
it might come back to bite them.
Like, they've got Hearts in a couple of weeks at Ibrox, and Hearts are flying
so
defensively.
A straightforward home win,
no,
you would imagine.
No, I wouldn't. I'll tell you right now, the way Hearts are playing just now,
Rangers will beat Hearts. 100%.
I'm scared to say what I'm thinking.
What?
I'm not going to sing Follow Follow. I'm not going to put
myself
in that
position.
No,
you've already sung that, exactly.
I'm not going to sing Simply the Best either, but I think that we could stop.
Rangers will beat Hearts.
I think we've got a chance of stopping that Rangers juggernaut. I think we've got a good chance. We're a really good side, Stephen. And Stephen, we're a really good side. We now know how to win games.
You're Man City.
We now know how to win games even when we're not playing great. We've got a goal in us. And that's where we are a threat to Celtic and Rangers. We could be the team that ultimately decides who wins the title.
Okay. I mean, that's
how good we are.
Quite the turnaround from a few weeks ago when you wanted Stephen Naismith sacked.
But yeah, Rangers win, but yeah, it was 2-0, but not great.
Partick Thistle 2, Livingston 3, a great comeback from Livingston. Thistle were two goals up, and then they chucked it all away. Joe Newbley, one very good finish.
Brilliant finish.
From him. Was it a toe poke? Don't know if it was a toe poke.
Top corner, toe poke.
Could have been a toe poke. I think it was a toe poke. And then obviously Yenge with the header right at the death as well. So that'll be a boost for Davy Martindale going back into Scottish Premiership action this weekend. They play St Mirren on Saturday.
The talk going into that game, if they lost it, Martindale was gone. That was the talk going into it. So he needed that. The club needed that. Because I think they were on a run of 17 games without a win.
Partick Thistle doing Partick Thistle things, though. Aye. I mean, there's barely any other team who can be 2-0 up and then just completely chuck it. The playoffs last season against Ross County as well.
Aye.
Where they were three goals up with 15 minutes to go or whatever it was. So, they'll be kicking themselves 2-0 up at home on Saturday and manage to chuck it. And obviously Livingston drawn away to Celtic in the next round of the Cup, because Celtic, after all the sort of huffing and puffing before the match, were pretty comfortable yesterday.
Yeah, I thought St Mirren started well.
Yeah, they did. They started well.
But as soon as the first goal goes in, I thought Celtic won it quite easily, to be honest with you. Again, without being great.
Yeah.
Just needed to get over the line, and that's all you want for your team. If you're not playing great, get the win.
That's where the chat sort of came from yesterday. We were just saying, you know, both Celtic and Rangers are not great. They're not great to watch.
No.
There's no players where you're getting excited to see them or anything like that. And you know, we were talking about last week, because you were saying there's a lot of empty seats at the Hibs-Celtic match last week. And I was sort of like, but watching Celtic and Rangers now, there's no attraction. Like, I remember going to see Dunfermline play Celtic and Rangers at East End, in the old terrace in East End.
What, in the noughties?
No, it would have been the 90s.
And, you're talking big stars.
Yeah, you're talking like, you know, Loudrop and Gascoigne and McCoist, and then you had Van Hooydonk and DeCanio,
Cadetti,
You know, even like, you know, big Scotland internationals that, you know, we used to see.
Your Paul Lambert's this world and all
that. Exactly, Colin Hendry, guys like that. So there was always a sort of, and it was always a sellout. It was always the biggest game of the season. But, you know, I just went and looked at Hearts attendances for last season, and Celtic and Rangers were among the lowest attended matches.
Yeah.
Because there's no attraction and they'll probably get beat.
Aye.
So what's the point?
Who was the last star player? I mean, like box office for Celtic and Rangers. Do you know what I'm getting at here? Because
I
remember when I was...
Well, there's obviously been good players.
No, I'm talking about like when I was on the Real Radio Football phone-in.
Yeah.
There's a new producer, so he doesn't need to press a button. No, don't you dare! Don't you dare!
Press it. Press it, Scott. Press it.
Oh,
press
it.
This is the Real Football phone-in.
Yes.
With Ewan Cameron and
he gets
Alan
the
Ruff.
Job.
Call
well done, producer
on
Scott. There we go.
Mate.
So, you'd have like Craig Bellamy turning up.
Mm-hmm.
And Roy Keane. Janinho.
Robbie Keane.
Robbie Keane as well. all turning up. And then you looked at the likes of Rangers and that, and the Torandre Flows, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Your Jean-Alaine Boom songs and people like that. When was the last time that Celtic or Rangers brought in a star name like that? And I know it's throwing that one at you right now without giving you much time to think about it, but the last big name where you go, wow, that's box office. For me, it would be Steven Gerrard, but he's not a player, he's a manager. And I would also put Brendan Rodgers into that category, but again, he's a manager and not a player because he'd come from the Premiership, having done well with Swansea and Liverpool. So, but in regards to the playing side of things, who was the last Juninho? Who was the last Robbie Keane? Who is, do you know what I'm getting at?
Yeah, I know. I don't think there's been any. And there's certainly none now. Like, absolutely none now.
No.
Whatsoever.
I'm trying to think. Who else would there be?
Even looked at the St. Mirren's attendances this season have been really, really good. And then yesterday, it was way down on what it usually was.
If there's any Rangers or Celtic fans out there that can correct us, who was the last box office signing that either club brought to Scotland, let us know. I wouldn't put Jermaine Defoe in there, so don't you anyone suggest that, because that's definitely not that.
I don't think anyone would suggest that.
But I'm just saying, he was at the age where...
I mean, what I would say is, everybody probably looked at Aaron Ramsey and thought, that's a big signing, and it turned out to be absolutely terrible.
But I didn't think it was a big signing at the time because of his injury problems. Coming from Juventus, I understand.
He signed from Juventus.
Yeah, okay.
You know, he was a big-name player.
Yeah.
But he obviously just didn't deliver at all.
Maybe give you that one at the time when it happened.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, okay. Well done, Stephen.
Well, thank you very much. Okay, so that is the Scottish Cup all done and dusted for another 2-3 weeks, and then we'll have the quarterfinals in the next wee while. I think it's the first full weekend in, is it the 8th and 9th of March or something like that? I think it's the second weekend in March, I seem to recall.
See, if you don't know the answer to your own question, then why are you bother asking
it? It's the 9th of March. Okay, Scottish Premiership, there was one match yesterday, and it looked like St Johnstone were heading for all 3 points against Dundee at Dens Park, but Luke McCowan scored from the penalty spot, and then Jordan McGee, 89th minute winner. That means Dundee are into the top six. This is how tight the Premiership is at this moment in time, because if you look at it, St Johnstone were going to be in the top six had they won yesterday. However, Dundee turned it around. Now it's Dundee that are in the top six, and I think St Johnstone are down in 10th place.
And they're now 5 points behind Dundee.
Yes, exactly. So it's all very tight, and it was a big win for Dundee because we've given them a lot of praise on this podcast this season, yeah. But of late, what is it, 2 wins in 12?
2 wins in 12.
Before yesterday.
Yeah.
So they were under a wee bit of pressure, but that has sort of eased off a little bit. And yeah, they're going to be fine, Dundee. I think St Johnstone will be fine as well, to be perfectly honest.
I still don't think Dundee will be in the top six. I think Hibs and Aberdeen will come good and catch them.
We'll see. In the Championship, there was only one game this week, and it was another rotten game because it finished on fair 1-0, Queen's Park 3.
We gave you a bit of stick last week, and I actually felt sorry for you after that show. I thought we went a wee bit over the top, if I'm being honest, but fuck me, that was funny. Watching you get beat again at the weekend from Queen's Park, who are pish, and they go to East End Park,
to be fair,
they win 3-0.
Well, they've actually won 3 in a row, Queen's Park.
Is James McPate still in charge?
Yes.
He's a nice guy, and I think he's got enough credit in the bank to get
James
a wee
McPake
bit longer.
Will be in charge for Saturday.
See, after what you did last year.
It's our bros at home on Saturday, and if we don't win on Saturday, I think there'll be big questions there. Yeah.
What would be really, really funny is if you swap places with Falkirk. I mean, it would be funny for the podcast.
No, it wouldn't be funny for the podcast, and it wouldn't be funny at all, really.
If truth be told, I don't want you to go down because I want Falkirk and Dunfermline in the same division next year, because that is just great for Scottish football.
So, haven't scored in 3 games. You know the weird thing is? So, obviously, lost 3-0 on Saturday, lost 5-0 to Morton the week before. Mm. The week before that, went to Tannadice and got a 0-0 draw. So,
going wrong.
We still have, I know I sound like a broken record here, we still have so many injuries.
Yeah.
There was a picture at halftime on Saturday, there was some kids doing some charity walk or something
like that. Oh, you showed that to me.
And there was all the injured players there, and there was 9 injured players.
Five.
At least 6 of them would be starting.
Yeah.
At least 6 of them. And I'm just like, well, you know.
Listen, no team in the Premiership could cope with that. So a team like Dunfermline in the Championship are never going to be able to cope with
James McPake did come out swinging after the game, said that this team will not be relegated.
He's right.
That's what
think
he said.
Will. You won't.
And he said that there's a couple of experienced players coming in this week.
Good.
And they're working hard on that. So hopefully that will make all the difference.
You will not get relegated. The fear is that you drop into the playoffs, but then I look at teams that you might face in the playoffs. If you do drop into that, you'll be fine.
Dunfermline's playoff record is...
But you'll be fine.
So bad.
Under James McPake and that squad of players you've got, you'll be fine.
Hopefully it doesn't get to that. Right, League One, Alloa beating Stirling Albion by a goal to nil on Saturday. Their ninth win of the season keeps them in fifth place. Big result for Falkirk, and they weren't even playing because Hamilton lost 3-2 at home to Annan. So that's a huge win for Annan as well. They're obviously trying to escape the relegation playoff spot at the bottom because Edinburgh are rooted. But Hamilton look to have completely chucked it now. Kelty Hearts 0, Queen of the South 0, nothing happening there. Montrose 3-0 winners against Edinburgh City. And Edinburgh haven't won a game since November, and they're 15 points adrift. At the bottom of League One. So Edinburgh City will be playing League Two football next season. Speaking of League Two football, let's get to the president.
Hey, Ian and Stefan, only kidding. You guys are the two names I never forget. Ian and Stephen, it was all about Dick in League to this week. Dick Campbell, that is, as he returned to Scotland's greatest league and managed to get a point off my Warriors. We are still 16 points clear at the top, though, so no biggie. Jobby McCall is finding it hard down here, though, as Clyde got beat again by Stranraer this time and are stranded at the bottom by 10 points. Elgin got a last-minute goal to beat Spartans to 2-1, while in the other game, Dumbarton and Forfar fought out an entertaining Desmond. I'll be back next week, Ian and Stefan. Smell you later. Biden out.
See you, Joe. There he goes.
Did he say smell you later?
Smell you later is what he said. Yep, smell you later.
Cheers, so, Joe.
Cheers, Joe. Right, time for some refereeing decisions.
La gente está muy loca.
What the fuck? Is there any?
Yeah.
Do we have some?
Yeah, there was also some from last midweek as well, if you remember.
So oh, we'll, so actually didn't
we'll,
list,
we'll, okay. we'll briefly cover them.
Go on then.
So let's start with the weekend games. So Scott Brown was having a wee moan about this, about Fabio Silva saying he shouldn't have been on the pitch to score the second goal.
Here, a bit like last week. Who was the one last week who got a yellow card to begin? Oh, Naroki.
Yeah.
Naroski.
Yeah.
The Celtic defender. His first one was near a yellow card, and then they're all moaning and greeting that the second one should have been a yellow card and a sending off. Well, I didn't think the first one was, and I thought the same for Fabio. I thought the first one wasn't a yellow, but I thought the second one was.
Connor Goldson lunge not looked at by VAR.
Yeah.
Yep.
They should have looked at it.
Yep.
But was that sending off?
Well, it was Connor Goldson, probably not. To be honest. You can just hand ball in the box regularly, you know. Connor Goldson does what he wants. Willie Collum, he booked Scott Brown, and obviously that brought back good memories for Scott Brown, I'd imagine, as well. So
I thought Scott Brown conducted himself great on Saturday there. I thought he was very good. And I thought he was very good in the build-up to the game and after the game as well. He had a point about Fabio, but I don't think Fabio's first challenge was a yellow card.
Lewis Palmer got booked in the box for diving.
Yes.
Okay.
It was very similar to Martin Boyle's from the midweek game against Celtic. Mm-hmm. Very similar dive.
Liam Gordon fell on Bakayoko that leads to the VAR penalty for Dundee. So
what's his name? Craig Levein wasn't happy with that.
Yeah, Craig Levein was absolutely right.
But I thought it was a penalty.
Okay, so obviously we had the situation at the weekend where there is VAR for some games and no VAR for other games.
Correct.
Partick conceded from a corner, which shouldn't have been a corner. Now,
can't use VAR for that.
Can't use VAR for
There's
that.
There's no point
anyway,
talking about
so,
it.
Elsewhere, midweek games last week. Now, there was Bolton sending off for St Mirren. He missed the game yesterday. It was against Dundee.
Dundee, yeah. And their narrow win.
They obviously appealed it and it got upheld, which is, it was never a sending off.
No, it wasn't.
In a million years.
Correct.
However, was it not the case that he was already on a booking?
Correct.
And he probably would have
got yellow for it anyway because of being rash.
But that, surely that's besides the point. It wasn't a straight red.
It was a rash challenge.
It wasn't a rash challenge.
No, it was rash in regards. When you look at full speed, I mean, he does go flying in.
No,
he does. He flies. No, Steve, it's not a red card.
He tackles him with his... He pulls out.
I know, Stephen. Stephen. It's not a red card, but I think he may have got a second yellow had the referee deemed a second yellow, and we'd have been sat here not complaining about the second yellow. And I think that's why they've probably upheld it, going, well, I think, put it this way, see if it wasn't a second yellow card offence, which I think at worst it was, mm-hmm. or just a yellow card offence. If he hadn't had a yellow card to begin with before making that challenge, I think they dismissed that red card.
But that's ludicrous. That's besides the point.
I know what you're saying. They should ignore that and just judge that's it irrelevant. On what it is.
You judge, yeah. you judge the challenge and what it's not the circumstances not. Of the match.
Correct. But yeah, I agree with you. It's a yellow at worst.
Right. The other big decision from last midweek was Stirling's sending off against Aberdeen. Now, Don Robertson was asked to go and look at the monitor after he'd sent it off.
Yes.
Don Robertson looked at the monitor and went, I've got the right decision, and stuck with his decision.
Well, I messaged you straight away, mm-hmm. and I actually applauded John Robertson for sticking by his decision. We need referees to do that more often. Now, whether they're right or wrong is irrelevant. The referee needs to stick by what he believes to be the right decision. I want more of that in the game. Now, some of us might agree that it was the correct decision. Some of us might think that was a poor decision. I thought, when you look at full pace, it could be deemed dangerous and reckless. So I can see where the referee's coming from. So from his position at that time, he's got it right. Now, you can look at it in slow motion and think, well, it's not that bad.
Yeah.
But I think fair play to the referee for sticking by his decision. That's what I would say about
it. I thought Sterling was a bit unlucky, to be honest.
No, I know what you mean, but I think fair play to the referee for sticking to his guns with that one.
Okay.
Right. Here's what I'm going to say, though. Here's what I'm going to say. Was the decision made easy because Rangers already 2-1 up?
I mean, possibly. I don't know. I mean, it shouldn't.
But what I'm saying is, does it make decision easier? Because
I mean, there was still 8 minutes stoppage time or something.
Because you're at Ibrox. I mean, fair play to the referee. The pressure he's under at Ibrox in a Scottish Cup tie, sorry, in a league tie with Aberdeen, where Rangers need to win to go level in points. It's huge pressure. Is it made easier because they're already 2-1 up?
Possibly.
I'm just, from a mindset.
But then had Rangers considered an equaliser, could you imagine?
Oh, it would have been fun.
You know what I mean? It would have been absolutely calm.
See the two penalties that Celtic got with the two penalties against Hibs?
I
thought the first one was reckless because he was never getting there and he's put the boy in hospital. But I also understand the other argument, which is you see players who challenge for the ball and there's a head knock, and then there's nothing done about it.
I don't know. Like,
he was a bit late.
I think for both of them, if I'm a Hibs fan, I'm not very happy.
You've seen many a player get shot off and then get hit late and then they don't do anything about it.
It's one of my bugbears that players get shots off and then get nailed after that.
Taken out.
And they're like, oh no, but you got your shot away. And I'm like, yeah, but that's still a foul.
Foul, yes.
Keepers are the worst at doing it.
Correct.
So sometimes what'll happen is the player will dink it over the goalkeeper and maybe hit it wide and then the goalkeeper wipes out the striker.
Yes.
And then they're like, oh no, it's just a goal kick. And I'm like, but that should be a foul.
Yeah.
It happens all the time.
I think the referee got it right in regards to the in regards to the challenge and what happened afterwards. But
I think
what
it was probably a penalty, but that'll happen another 10 times a season and it won't be given.
So that referee, I'm going to keep an eye on him.
Okay.
Because let's see if he continues that consistency. If you get your shot off and you get wiped out after the shot has been taken, are you going to be given a penalty?
I think it should be a penalty, but it's very rarely given.
I agree.
Okay, right. That's VRWTF. Let's move on then, shall we?
The Big Scottish Football Podcast with Stephen Mill and Ewan Cameron.
Right, start, stop, sell. It was our version, or is our version, of Snog, Marry, Avoid. You need to decide which one of the three options you would start, which one you stop, which one you sell. Last week, it was James Bond.
Oh, yes.
So it was Daniel Craig, Roger Moore and Sean Connery after much debate. So Nicola Doyle says, start Daniel Craig, he is a no-nonsense player, I should say. Sub Roger Moore, he's won a golden gun. And sell Sean Connery, he'd know if he's heeding the game because he wants to go to Rangers like Lauren Shankland. Big G says, start Connery, sub Moore, sell Craig. Interesting. Alan says, start Craig, sub Connery and sell Moore. Craig R says, start, sub, sell. Firstly, producer John is right. Brosnan is the best Bond.
Who's that? Who says that?
Craig R.
Craig, you're useless, mate. You've not got a clue when it comes to Bond. You've clearly not watched anything other than Pierce Brosnan Bond movies, because Timothy Dalton's better, Daniel Craig's better. I'd even go as far as say Roger Moore's better, and he's pish as far as I'm concerned. I'm not a fan of Sean Connery either. Even he's better than Pierce Brosnan. Even the boy that just did the one Bond movie, George Lazenby, is better than Brosnan.
Well, he actually mentioned him there. He was like, I would take the Celtic approach. Sell them all for 20 million and loan in Lazenby. sell Daniel because, well, I don't want to actually say why, because if you've not seen the last Daniel Craig film.
Well, he dies. What do you mean not to?
Why do you always spoil things for people?
But this is years old. Everybody knows
he's
dead.
I know, but.
People know he dies, isn't it? He gets blown up in the end on the island. And his girlfriend's watching.
Just leave a little something for people who want to watch the films and discover it themselves.
But Stephen,
it's like
going, let's not talk about Darth Vader being Luke Skywalker's dad. I am your father.
Not quite. That was 40 years ago.
No, but it's the same thing. Like,
don't know.
Bruce Willis is dead in The Sixth Sense. Everybody knows that. Everybody knows he's dead.
Could you please stop spoiling films?
No, but these movies are old, and everybody knows the answer.
Yeah, they're old movies. That movie's about 3 years old.
What? Psycho. It's the guy
from the 1960s.
And everyone knows that the mum is actually the guy who actually runs the hotel, pretending to be his mum.
Dave says, Sell Craig comes flying at the traps, but has the worst finish of any Bond. Start Connery, wily, combative, and can always get you out of trouble. However, ban him from interviews and talking about women. Sub Moore knows how to make a grand entrance and always ends up on top. Kaffer says, Start Moore, tremendous shooting skills in Moonraker and could get past Jaws easily. Sub Connery for his experience. Was Bonnie Rigg Rose. He did play with Bonnie Rigg when he was a younger man. And Sell Craig for failing to protect M in Skyfall. Craig says, Start Craig, sub Sean and Sell Moore. Unless it's Cannonball Run Moore, then he can make the bench. Neil says, Start Craig is the only one that shows damage in a fight. Sub Connery and Sell Moore, as he's an annoying fud. JR says, Start Bond, sub Bond, sell Bond. It's really easy to be honest with you. Very, very clever. A few other ones as well. P. Mac B says, surely Sean shits on the bench. Plus, need to fulfil the homegrown Scottish quota for Europe anyway. A very good point. Start Daniel and sell Roger. So, based on your votes, start Craig, sub Connery, bin Moore. Now, we've got a couple of choices for this week's contenders for start, sub, sell.
Go on.
I've got a couple of different topics.
Go on.
It's the Chinese New Year.
Oh, it's the dragon.
Yes, the year of the dragon. Is it the year of the dragon?
I watched some dragons in the... what's the shopping centre that we go to on a Saturday?
The St. James Quarter.
St. James Quarter. There was a couple of dragons running around there the other, on Saturday for the Year of the Dragon.
Okay.
It was very visual and very nice to see.
Lovely. Excellent. So
so what's that? How would there be a start sub sell for that?
Your favourite Chinese food. Because obviously Chinese takeaways might be closed over the next couple of weeks, because a lot of Chinese takeaways do take the Chinese New Year off for a couple of weeks.
You're the dragon and stuff, so your favourite things are Chinese restaurant.
So we could do that, or since it's Valentine's Day on Wednesday...
Something to do with love.
Something to do with love, so...
I know what to do. Missionary, right. Doggy, or the wheelbarrow.
No, Ewan, we're not doing that. We're not doing that. For a number of reasons.
Can I pick the wheelbarrow?
For a number of reasons, we're not doing that. We can't do that. We've been through this before.
Okay, so we can't do that then?
No, so something else Valentine's related that's not that or to do with that.
Right, but what else happens on Valentine's Day? Oh, you're talking about like a meal deal from like Marks and Spencer's or Lidl or Tesco.
I was leaving it open to you, right. And you've chosen to go down that route.
No, well, I can't think of anything else that you do on Valentine's
Day.
So
let's go for the Chinese takeaways then.
No. Let's just. So what else happens on Valentine's Day?
Maybe gifts, flowers, chocolates.
Come on, mate! Missionary dog game wheelbarrows.
We can do that. Producer John will lose his shit. If we do that. They can do that.
I know. Can you imagine putting the pictures up on Twitter for
no,
that?
No, I can't.
can you imagine? Imagine the reaction if we were, because see what we do when we come, we start sub-sell, we put pictures up of what we're discussing and what you need to decide who's to start, who's to sub and who's to sell. Can you imagine producer John Allen, he'd find three images to put on Facebook and Twitter.
Probably and with our boss, faces.
And then our faces over. Can you imagine our boss's reaction?
We can do that, Ewan.
Okay, right, what else is Valentine's Day famous for? Cards, chocolate, meal deals, wine, Prosecco, presents. That's quite boring, isn't it?
Yeah.
Love songs.
Love songs?
Like people who sing love songs. We could pick three singers.
Three famous...
Singers.
Barry White.
Barry White, the walrus. He's the what's it called? The walrus of love?
Yep, the walrus of love. I'm not sure that is his name.
I think he is called the walrus.
Right, okay.
The walrus of love. So go Barry White.
So Barry White.
Oh, George Michael, Careless Whisper.
George Michael. Okay, that's
In Different Corners, a great song.
George Michael and...
Love songs.
Famous Valentine songs.
Love songs.
Famous Valentine's.
I do like Al Green, Let's Stick Together. Stay Together.
Lionel Richie. Adele.
Oh, Adele's a good shout. What's the big famous one that she did? There's quite a few right enough.
She's had quite a lot.
Make You Love Me. What's that song called? You Make Me Love Me. Make Love to Me.
Make You Feel My Love.
That's the one.
Right.
So go Barry, Adele and George.
Okay, right, fine. Barry White, Adele.
And George.
And George
for
Michael.
For start, sub, sell for the football.
Okay.
Who's starting, who's the sub, and who's sold.
A Valentine's special as well. A Valentine's special for start, sub, sell. Barry White, George Michael or Adele. Who you starting, who you subbing, who you selling. It's at Big Football Scott for that. And you can get us on Twitter with that handle. Also on Facebook and Instagram as well. And you can subscribe on YouTube. Just search for Clyde One Super Scoreboard on YouTube. And we've got our own wee video section as well there. So that is very nice. Remember, leave your comments there. And remember, Clyde One Super Scoreboard on the air every single weekday night from 6 p.m. taking your calls across Glasgow and the West and beyond on 0141 951 1025.
Can we title this podcast The Wheelbarrow?
The Wheelbarrow, yes we can. Yes we can.
And only the people who've listened to it will now understand why we've called the podcast The Wheelbarrow.
Speaking of people who make love like no one else, it's time to call Jose.
Oh, Jose Quitongo! Jose.
Now, it's a wee bit later than usual, so don't know if we'll get him. And obviously, it's only 2 days away for Valentine's Day, so he'll be a busy man. Be out collecting.
Hello?
Stuff. Jose!
Jose!
Hello, boys. How are you?
Not too bad.
I was just saying there, it's Valentine's Day, 2 days' time. This is your busy time of the year, isn't it?
No Valentine this year, man.
I thought you had three girlfriends sorted.
No, but listen, boys, I swear, I'm happy to be single, eh?
Are you not like on a dating app or something? Do you not have a lady for Valentine's Day?
No, because I just feel Valentine's Day costs a fortune, man. They just want the present all the time and eat out all that stuff. No, I'm like, this Valentine's Day, maybe I find girlfriend after Valentine's Day.
So you stop seeing the ladies before Valentine's Day because it's too expensive. That's what you're saying. You're a tight arse. Yeah. That's what you're saying. That's what you're admitting to, Jose.
No, I'm not saying that.
You bloody are. It's
I'm
true.
Not saying that. Bah. Oh, but I'm not saying that, boys. But. No, is it difficult to find somebody? You know what I mean? The moment.
Yeah.
The girl's problem, man. The girl's problem. I just happen to be myself at the moment.
Okay.
So are you going to have a wee sort of meal deal for yourself on Wednesday night? Maybe go to M&S and treat yourself?
Yes. Meal for myself. Go in the gym in the morning, do all my stuff. And then nighttime, we meal, we glass the water, do me fine.
Excellent.
Well, you have a lovely Valentine's Day, my friend. It's been lovely speaking to you again.
Thank you, boys. Thank you.
Cheers, Jose. Bye-bye.
Love you.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Let's get his chant on again.
Jose, 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 Jose.
It's a tight arse.
Jose, Jose.
Right, there goes Jose. Time for Scottish football's even harder, hardest question. So, are you getting any closer to this? The answer inside this envelope.
Somebody's close to it.
This was sealed on the 8th of January. We're now more than a month after this was sealed.
Yeah, but you were on holiday for a week, so we didn't do it that week.
So, what is the connection between Scotland's most expensive footballer and Dexys Midnight Runners? Dell says Dexys Midnight Runners song Gino is about a soul singer from Nottingham, Gino Washington, and Ollie Burke played for Nottingham Forest. Fraser says Jordan Rhodes' relative Bernard Rhodes used to manage Dexys Midnight Runners. Agent 72, Bander from Birmingham, and Burke plays currently for Birmingham City. It's as simple as that. Derek FM says, is it as simple as Dexys are a Celtic folk band or Celtic folk band and Burke played for Celtic? He then followed it up with another tweet saying, actually, looking into this a bit deeper, the Dexys at one time were reduced to just Roland and Patterson, who were referred to as the Celtic Soul Brothers. Ollie Burke played for Celtic.
Oh, that sounded really well thought through.
I can tell you.
It sounded got it right.
That... nobody's got it right again. So we keep rolling on at Big Football Scott. At Big Football Scott.
Can we just confirm, there please, Stephen? Can we please just confirm? We're talking about Ollie Burke here, right? We're 100% talking about Ollie Burke, but we need you to just admit that. Just please just tell us it's that. Because I don't want it's going on forever because it's going to do my nothing.
It's meant to be difficult.
Yeah, I know it is, but that's still making it difficult by just admitting it's Ollie Burke because everyone's having a guess it's Ollie Burke. So it clearly is him.
I would say that some people are going in the right direction.
Right, okay, so it's all about Ollie Burke. So we need to find a connection. Somebody do with Ollie Burke and Dexys Midnight Runners. The answer is out there somewhere, and I have full faith in somebody getting it right. Apparently your pal's got it right.
There is my pal who...
Somebody who's obsessed with this part of the show.
Yeah, he basically got it.
And what's his name?
Rory.
Well done to you, Rory. So there is somebody out there who's got it right, but we can't let him play because he's pals with Stephen.
Yes.
But we need one of yous out there to please, please, please get their answer right because it's doing my fucking head in.
What is the connection between Scotland's most expensive footballer...
Ollie Burke.
...and Dexys Midnight Runners?
The big band from the 1980s who are currently... gone on tour. It's just Scottish, announced a new tour.
Scottish football's even harder, hardest question. Maybe you'll get it right next week. You can leave your answers on YouTube or at Big Football Scott. You can tweet us direct as well if you've got any theories. At Stephen Mill, at Ewan D. Cameron as well. Okay, it's time for the quiz, everyone. Yes! Here we go. Right, play the bed. Okay, so no producer John this week, and Ewan spent a very stupid amount of time slagging off producer Scott, despite the fact he's the person who has to answer the or give us the questions here.
Yes, can I just say from last week, I was kicking myself all week, and it really annoyed me that I went 1875 for the year that Aberdeen were formed, and I actually said the answer 1903, but as everyone keeps telling me, and I've heard this throughout my career and throughout my life, always go with your first answer. Well, how that didn't work for me last week.
No,
I went with my first answer and it was wrong, and I should have gone with my second answer, so I ended up losing the quiz and it really pissed me off. So what I'm going to be doing this week, because I find that you being here and talking pish is really distracting.
Right.
Really distracting. And the dramatic music you play is really distracting, so I'm going to solve this problem. Hold on.
Right. He's going across his bag. Yep, he's got his bag. Unzipping his bag.
Yeah, hold on a second.
That's his bag, he's unzipping. Yeah, there it is. Yeah. What's that?
Those are sound-cancelling headphones. So
right.
When the question gets asked, I'm removing my headphones, I'm putting on my sound-cancelling headphones so I can hear your nonsense or the producer's nonsense, and I'm going to listen to some Vivaldi.
Right, okay. Well, we need a quiz host and master.
Yeah.
Come down, producer Scott. How are you doing? You okay?
Yes, glad to join you guys today. I was actually going to bring in some easier questions for Ewan, but he hasn't been very nice so far. So
yeah,
we'll see how that goes.
Exactly.
I don't need your help, you prat.
Right, if you've never seen the quiz before or heard the quiz before, this is how it works. It's a penalty shootout style. Me and you in alternate questions, and basically it's best of five. So if it goes to all the way through at the five, then we go to a tiebreaker if we can't be split between us. So that's just about it. Oh, top bin questions. So we can ask for a top bin question, which is worth 2 points. It's our discretion when we do that, and we need to flip the coin to decide who's going first.
Yeah, go on.
You call you in. So
heads. Oh my god,
it's
I lose
tails,
everything.
So I'll go first, Scott, if that's okay.
Yep.
Me go first, me versus Ewan. Here's question number one. Let's go. Some dramatic music, please. Right.
Okay. First question: who were the last team to beat Celtic in the League Cup?
In the League Cup?
Yes.
Oh, I like you, Scott.
That's actually slightly top bin-ish, that question.
If you think that's top bin, you should wait and see what the top bins actually are.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question.
Well, it was this season, because Rangers won the League Cup.
Oh, so it is. It's so easy now when I think about it.
But
shit.
I do know who it is. It's Kilmarnock.
So your answer is Kilmarnock?
Final answer.
So it is.
Well done.
Thank you.
Right, go on, give me my first question.
Okay, you've got this, Ewan.
Yeah.
Name any side Robbie McCrory has played with on loan from Rangers. Any side that Robbie McCrory has played for on loan from Rangers.
That's a goalkeeper.
That might be.
Hold on. I'm going to listen to some Vivaldi.
Right, but you can't just take ages. I don't know how soundproof it is either.
I think Vivaldi's songs are quite long as well.
Yeah, let's hope it's not too long, because we've all got a life to be getting on with.
Four Seasons is lovely from Vivaldi. Nice violin.
Just answer the question.
How long do we give them before it's just wrong?
Motherwell.
I don't know.
Right, he's got an answer.
He's got an answer. Right, good. Excellent. What's the answer?
Livingston. Final answer.
Livingston. Well done.
Thank you, Vivaldi.
Okay, one all. Back to you.
Yep.
So, who is the current top scorer in the Scottish Premiership?
Lauren Shankland
is correct.
Right, question two for me.
Yep.
Go on.
What SPFL Premiership team have a boat on their badge, Ewan? A boat.
Sound cancelling headphones on. I'm now going to listen to John Williams in Jurassic Park.
In the history of this podcast, this is probably
a boat on their back,
the most irritating and annoying thing that Ewan has done, and that's a long list. And a high bar for annoyance.
Got an answer?
Okay.
Headphones are off. Put these back on.
What's your answer?
Ross County.
Ross County. Do they have a boat on their badge?
No, they don't. Oh no 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 no. No.
What? No.
No.
Come
no,
on.
No. 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 It's not Ross
What's
County.
Your final answer,
it's
Ewan?
Not Ross County. It's definitely not Ross County.
Right,
sorry.
Well, what is your answer?
Sorry.
What is your answer?
My final answer is going to be the team that's got a boat on their badge is Kilmarnock.
Nice try.
Who is that?
We don't know. Can I have a guess at this?
Is it Motherwell?
Yeah, go for it.
It's Motherwell.
Is it like Morton?
No, it's Hibs.
I should have listened to Vivaldi. I made the mistake there listening to Jurassic Park. Oh, Jesus. Hibs have got a boat on their badge.
Yep.
Hibs have got a boat on their badge. Okay. Shit, I'm 2-1 down. Question three, Stephen.
Right. We're staying with badges, Stephen, here. What type of tree is on the Motherwell badge?
What type of tree is on the Motherwell badge? To go 3-1 up.
Fir tree?
A fir park!
A fir tree, final answer.
You would think so. Oh. And that is correct.
No! 3-1 up, go! What's my question?
Okay, Ewan. I reckon you'll get this one. Which former Scotland international now manages Southampton?
Hold on. Jesus Christ. Just put my sound-cancelling headphones on so I don't hear your pitch, Jack.
Just hurry up.
And I'm going to listen to the flying theme from E.T. Such a beautiful movie.
Just answer the question, Jesus.
Flying across the trees and the moon. Oh, I got my answer.
Okay.
That'll be final answer, Russell Martin.
Russell Martin, you sound confident, yeah. And you should be. That is a goal. Well done.
Thank you, my friend. That's 3-2 after question four for me. Question four for Stephen.
Okay, no. Stephen.
There's question four for you.
Yeah, but only three questions for you.
Yeah, but I've only got two right. It's 3-2.
Okay.
Stephen, how many Scottish teams has John McGinn played for?
Oh. Did he go on loan and shit like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. I don't think he did. So I'll go for two, final answer.
Before I let you know, do you want to try and guess what the two are?
St Mirren and Hibs.
St Mirren and Hibs
mm-hmm.
is correct. Well done.
He's 4-2 up after four questions.
See, I didn't think he'd been out on loan because you would have heard about that.
Right, Ewan.
This is my fourth question, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I'm 4-2
yeah,
down.
You have to get this one.
So if I don't get this right, you win the quiz offer. Or do I go top bin to go for all?
I think this one's a gimme. I think you'll get this one.
All right, then I'll just... No, because then if he gets the fifth one right, then he wins a quiz. All right, give me my fourth question.
The fourth question, okay.
Go on.
Who is the only North Macedonian international playing in the Scottish Premiership? North Macedonian international.
We just talked about him, we know. I don't even need to put my sound-cancelling headphones for this. I don't need to hear the Blue Danube by Johann Strauss. I'm going to go Miowski, final answer.
Miowski is correct. Well done.
4-3. 4-3. Stephen's final question. I'll make it. I'll please just get it wrong, Stephen, to make it interesting.
Shut up. Just okay. Give me the question.
Stephen.
You can't get 5 out of 5. That just shows how easy this fucking quiz is, and you're not coming back again if he wins this.
Well, you've got 3 out of 4.
Right. Well, just... Go, give it to him.
Okay. Which Celtic player currently has the number 9 jersey? Number 9.
I've not got a clue. I've not got a Scooby. It's not Keogh.
What number's he?
7, is he not?
No.
Nah, he is.
It's not.
Oh, no, Lewis Palmer's 7.
I'm but, keeping my mouth shut.
But I don't think Kyogo isn't 9, I don't think. Is he? Have they given it to that boy that's just come in? That Adam Ida or whatever his name is. I've honestly, I couldn't tell you. Don't think it's my Ida. I don't think it's Kyogo. Kyogo's 8. I'll have to go for the Ida, the new boy. Final answer.
Adam Ida to yep. win the quiz.
No, I'll not quite win the quiz, Ewan. You can still go top bin.
Oh, yeah, for my fifth question to draw it.
And move 1 point ahead. Yep.
Exactly. But I'll go Adam Ida.
He's right.
He is right.
I forgot about the top bin question. my fifth question to get it right, to go equal on points and go to a tiebreak.
Okay.
So it's 5-3. Top bin, I need this to go level. Come on, come on!
Okay. Top bin.
Go on.
Ewen, what is St Mirren's highest top flight finish in the SPL, SPFL era? St Mirren's highest
top flight
finish.
As in what
position? Position in the league.
Position in the league.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, sound cancelling headphones on. I'm now listening to... what I'm going to listen to. The love theme from Superman. It's that moment when Clark Kent, Superman, is flying through the sky with Lois Lane. You can see the Statue of Liberty. St Mirren. Do, do, do. Do, 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 do. Come on, Superman, help me. Oh, their highest ever position in SPL and SPFL history in the top flight. They never got second. Is it third or fourth? Right. I'm going to go for that. I've written it down. Right. Sound cancelling headphones off. Thank you, Superman. Third final answer.
Third position?
It was third or fourth. I've gone third. Please tell me. It was third. Please tell me. Just take it a tie break. Yes! Piece of shit.
I'm afraid you were miles off. The answer was seventh in the 2020-2021 season.
I don't need to hear all the detail. I don't need to hear the detail.
I don't think that's correct, Scott. Did they not finish sixth last season?
Well, producer John's written it down. Seventh.
I would.
Does it matter? Did they finish third or fourth?
I mean, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You
no, it doesn't
is still
matter.
Wrong.
It doesn't matter. And
he is still
listen,
wrong.
Can we stop the quiz now?
I mean, no.
I mean, genuinely.
Champions League music, please, Scott. Champions League music.
It's boring. It's really boring.
It's not.
It is because you win every week.
What's boring
you win
about
every
this?
Single week. It's boring. It's like the Scottish Premiership when Rangers were in the fourth division. The League Three, and then Celtic were just winning league after league after league after league after league, and there was no challenge apart from when Aberdeen nearly did it in 2014. It's been pish, and this is pish. Now you got Rangers back, there's a bit more of a challenge and something more to look forward to. You got Hearts that are coming up as well, but this game is worse than when Celtic were in the league and walking and winning trebles left, right and centre. This is worse than that. This is more boring than that, and I'm fucking sick of it. So I think we should end the quiz. Let's not do it anymore because I'm getting bored of it and I'm now leaving. Thanks.
I mean, you could just...
Who came up with the idea with the quiz? Oh, it was me.
Yeah.
That was me. Aye.
You could just not be shite at the quiz.
Oh, that... Stephen, I actually think the quiz is actually it's actually engineered for you to look good.
How's it in... I don't
it's
need...
engineered to make you look good because...
I need no engineering to look good.
Because you're really into Scottish football.
You host the Scottish football podcast.
Yeah, and also, but then when I did the football phone, that was like in the noise. And all these questions are fucking daft.
What do you mean they're daft?
They're just daft. It's all about League One pish and League Two and Championship.
There was no League One or League... Like, the question you got wrong was about Hibs.
I can't get out of here. How can I get out?
Right, play the outro music, please, Scott. And I'll let him out. Okay.
I'll do the podcast next week if we don't drop this quiz.
Right, okay. The quiz will be back next week. Whether Ewen Cameron is or not, then who knows. But, you know, fingers crossed he's not. Have a great week, everyone. And remember, get in touch for everything on @BigFootball. Scott, start, sub, sell. We've got our Valentine's special there as well. We've got Scottish football's even harder, hardest question. Hopefully, you'll get it right sometime soon. And then, obviously, get in touch for anything else. Leave your comments on YouTube, @BigFootballScott. And enjoy the rest of your week. And make sure you're listening to Clyde One Super Scoreboard every single night from 6 o'clock. Me and Ewen will be back this coming Saturday, everywhere else, with a big Saturday football show. Enjoy your week, everyone. Ta-ta. Just did myself nowadays. Right.